thank all of you for coming. We have a few more people registering. Clarence Hightower is walking in the building as we're getting ready. There, if we have any, there were some, if you're feeling warm, this is the Minnesota mom and me, unzip your coat, take it off. There's a few places back in the back still where there were hangers a few minutes ago. So thank you all so very much for coming, and we are going to get started as soon as Clarence is up here. Good morning, Clarence. So I've been doing a number of town halls, and then after the town halls, people have come up to me and said, you know, I didn't get my question, and I would have liked a little more detail on this, or can you, you know, kind of drill down a little more in topics of town halls. So we're going to continue to do general town halls, but many of you who have been involved in my congressional office over the years now, it's not unusual for us, and we've been doing this for years, to have very specific conversations every once in a while. We had one on climate change yesterday at St. Thomas, because I had people saying no one's asking questions on climate change, and I have questions on that. We heard from many of the seniors when we did some of the first town halls on the Affordable Care Act that they wanted more information, kind of more, a little more senior focused, and so that's the focus on this one. We will be having more opportunities to engage and come together on other things. So there is a questionnaire that's been put out, and if there's a topic that you think needs to be covered a little more in depth before we get a panel together, like I want to thank our panel for being here today. We're our office is more than happy to work to do that. So once again, thank you for all our panelists for coming. Thank you. I was with Mark Seeley yesterday, and he held off the storm for us. So thanks. St. Thomas on our climate change one. And I thought it was just awesome to be at Hallie Q. Brown Center this month in February as we celebrate Black History Month. And as I walked in, I was watching people read the wonderful life stories and the accomplishments of the community here in Rondo. And I hope as you leave, if you haven't had a chance to learn more about Roy Wilkins or some of the former neighbors who lived in this neighborhood, that you please have an opportunity to do that. So I'm just going to make some brief remarks. We have some slides in front of us, because I want to get to the panel, and then we want to get to your questions. Now, we can all agree that the Affordable Care Act needs some tweaks. But what I've been faced with in Congress for the past 6 years are not tweaks. It is full out-out repeal. And we have heard from doctors and hospitals. We've heard from people who receive health care under the Affordable Care Act. And employers, some ways in which we can improve and enhance it. And we always knew that it was going to be tweaked as it went along. But the only opportunity we have ever been given is full repeal of the Affordable Care Act. And that is still the only thing that's on the table, because I've now heard that there's an outline out there for the Affordable Care Act. But I have yet to see a plan for the Affordable Care Act. And so we deserve to know what it's going to be replaced with, and it needs to be done in a smooth transition if that is their goal, and that is what I'm asking for as your member of Congress. So let's just go over a few things about the Affordable Care Act. $129 million Americans with pre-existing health conditions are protected from discrimination. And I have to tell you, those are the stories we're getting in our office all the time. Covering adults until they're age 26 has been huge for families. And that means for many of you, your children or your grandchildren can stay on an insurance plan. The Medicare donut hole shrinks, and it finally goes, I'm serving donut holes, it finally goes away. For recommended preventative wellness care, because we know that if you go in and you get something checked out first, you'll not only improve your health, but actually you'll also save dollars for yourself and for the federal programs that cover it. So here's my plug. Colonoscopies are not fun, but you're going to get one if you do one, right? Just shake your head. Colon cancer is a leading one of the leading cancers that if we catch early, we can save lives. That's my plug for that. My mom passed away from colon cancer, so Mom, I did it. So go get your, my mom told you to go get your screening. In Minnesota, our uninsurance rate has fallen to an all-time low of 4%. All Minnesotans, yeah, that's great. Our legislature, all Minnesotans enrolled in divisional health coverage will get financial help in 2016. Now, because of the Affordable Care Act, and this is important for many of you in this room, Medicare is now projected to remain solvent until 2028. 11 years longer than before the ACA. The ACA helped save dollars and lives. The ACA not only strengthened Medicare, it improved its benefits. And so I'm just going to reiterate them again. Free recommended and preventative care such as cancer, diabetes, and depression screenings. Free annual wellness checkups and lower prescription drug costs. And folks, there's more work to do on that front. I know that. You know that. We'll work on that together. By 2020, the ACA eliminates the donut hole. And if you know anyone, a friend, a neighbor, a family member, who before the ACA was in the donut hole, it was devastating to their financial well-being. Meant the difference back again, whether it was heating oil, paying your heating bill, and the kind of groceries that you felt you could afford to get the nutritious food for yourself. Like Medicare and Social Security, this program is a program that seniors with disabilities also rely on. So when we just, you know, the focus is on seniors, but it's also those in our community, many who I've worked with when I was in the State House, who are on disability, and the difference between many of them being able to get to work, make a doctor's appointment, fully participate the way that they should in everyday activities is because Medicare Medicaid is there. Like Medicaid and Social Security, these programs, as well as the ACA, deserve our full attention and, I believe, our full protection. Social Security is solvent until 2034, and looking ahead, here's what I'm hearing from my colleagues, and you've seen it in the paper. Congressional Republicans, besides wanting to repeal the Affordable Care Act, which hurts Medicare and all of us, they're also talking about a voucher program for Medicare and a block grant for Medicaid and for Social Security. So what happens just here in Minnesota, the ACA is repealed, 380 Minnesotans will lose their health insurance. We have many people in Minnesota, because of the ACA, are employed in healthcare, helping to lower those costs and helping you have a better quality of life. 401 Medicare beneficiaries will lose access from preventative services, and that's very, very important, not only in your personal health, but also in helping to keep health costs down here in the state, which we've been very focused on, and as I mentioned before, the donut hole returns. And then the prescription drug savings for people on Medicare, you know, over 66,000 people use that. And if we turn it into a voucher system, here's what happens. The healthcare cost shifts back onto you. And it's going to force you to pay more. It ends the Medicare guarantee as we know it, and it destroys Medicare as we know it. Another important program I'm going to touch on, because I do want to get to the panels, but I want to let you know where I'm on this, is that affects seniors, low-income people, and people with disabilities, is the medical assistance in Minnesota. The primary payer, long-term care and support services that many, many people in our community use. If the Republican leaders are successful and they are able to grant Medicaid, it would directly result in cuts to Medicaid services and make it hard for Minnesota and other people in states, residents, to get their health care needs met, because you'd have to bear the cost of these cuts. Let me just put this in something that I've been trying to undo with doing block grant for healthcare. The Indian Health Service basically block granted healthcare. And they said, Indian Health Service, these are all the dollars you get. That's it. And the tribal nations had a term for this, and it was called, don't get sick after August, there is no money. So if we go to a block grant here and something changes in the state, or you have needs, and that grant has been capped, or cut, or just put in place, you can find yourself all of a sudden having your health care rationed. There's no other way for me to vote. So right now, Minnesota covers 50% of the Medicaid, and the federal government covers the other half. And as I said, that block grant is essentially would be a sum of money that would be given back to the states, but it would be a sum of money. So if more people in Minnesota were to become eligible for Medicare, either the state or the counties would need to pick up the difference, and that would be because the state wouldn't have the funding coming in from the federal government. So I think we can figure out why that is not an idea that I'm supporting here. So let me just take a second to talk about Social Security. Social Security is a basic trust between those who have worked hard in our country and made a quality of life for my generation and the generations come to enjoy. It is also a safety net for children who find themselves in, you know, in situations without a household, without parents there to help, or parents there to help them. And it's also very important to people with disabilities. Privatization means severe cuts in benefits, huge increases in the national debt, and greater risk for people to live their full potential, those with disabilities and children. And it also means you not having the retirement plan that you would like to have for yourself when you retire. So simply repealing and cutting and privatizing these important programs is not a solution. If we need to tweak and fix them, it's not about what the Republicans have in mind. We should strengthen and improve these programs. So what I'm here today, questions, and we need to work together. I need to hear from you. The senators need to hear from you. Other representatives need to hear from you. People on the committees of jurisdiction need to hear from you that you're an American, you care about what is happening to these programs, and you're saying no. So you need to make sure that your voices are heard. So I'm going to turn this over to this panel of excellent experts here. And they work on many of the programs that we discussed, from everything from economic security to nutritional assistance, now called SNAP, the Older Americans Act, and they are just a great group of folks. So I'm going to introduce them, and then I'm going to have them, to keep things flowing, I'm going to have them come up to the podium. They're going to speak for a few minutes, and about 20 minutes of remarks, and then I'm going to turn it over to you. So first, you will hear from as Clarence Hightower. He's the Executive Director of Community Action Partnership in Ramsey, Washington County. He's one of the largest community action agencies in Minnesota. He has 34 years of executive experience in the Twin Cities nonprofit sector. Mr. Hightower, and I read it, writes a regular column in the Minnesota Spokesman Recorder called the Anti-Poverty Soldier to address the inequities and to elevate the discussion on poverty. Then we're going to hear from Carrie Benson. She's the director of the Minnesota Department of Human Services, Aging and Adult Services Division, and the executive director on the Board of Aging. So she's helping us focus down on what you asked me for. She also provides statewide aging service leadership and oversees planning for providing sustainable financial housing and service options for older Minnesotans. Carrie manages Minnesota state federally funded home community-based services and critical services such as the Senior Linkage Line, the Adult Protection and Long-Term Care Ombudsman. Our host today is Jonathan Palmer, the Executive Director for Hallie Q. Brown. And he is a person who hosted me this summer when I was hoping that my focus on healthcare would not be quite enough to repeal the ACA, but that we would be working on racial disparities in healthcare. And we had a marvelous summary. And now we're just making sure we don't slide backwards. But you have my commitment, all of you, to work on racial disparity issues into the future. Really history and a way back out. Last but certainly not least is Erin Parrish. She's the Associate Director in Advocacy for Outreach for AARP Minnesota. In her position, Erin is responsible for AARP's grassroots advocacy efforts in Minnesota, as well as mobilizing AARP's volunteers and members to engage in social impact activities related to AARP's activity. Erin has 10 years of experience in nonprofit management, government affairs, and grassroots. So now I'm going to turn it over to Clarence. Clarence.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for inviting me to be part of this conversation. I am absolutely excited to be here. And it is amazing to me that this is expected of me, that I expect our Congresswoman to have this kind of leadership on issues like our senior population. I mean, it is really interesting to me that she's not only interested in the issues, but she's interested in how the issues impact each of us. And so do me a favor and just honor her yet again. So I've been given 5 minutes to jumpstart this conversation about our senior population. And let me do that. I don't know that I'm going to speak, but I do just want to add to at least jumpstart the conversation. Let me start by discussing what I believe to be a paradigm shift in how we treat our senior population. When I was growing up, we valued our seniors. As a matter of fact, in our community, and like most young folks, when I did my little dirt, I never did anything in front of our seniors. I valued them, I appreciated them. Even my friends who used to curse a little bit and, you know, drink a little bit and smoke a little bit, we never did it in front of our seniors. We believed that our seniors, the great heaven they had, was a gift of wisdom from God, and so we just had this respect for them. I'm not convinced that we value our seniors in that way anymore, particularly as we look at what's coming out of this new administration. And so if you've been following at all the TV, you've noticed that these town hall meetings have been going on across the country, and some of them have not gone well. The reason they've not gone well, quite honestly, is that the folks leading those town hall conversations does not have the kind of commitment to these kinds of issues that Congressman McCollum has. So acknowledge that just one more time. Thank you for being a strong advocate for. Now, this is a conversation that we all have to have. The bottom line is our senior population is growing. As a matter of fact, in 2 short years, I will be considered a senior citizen and looking forward to it. Factually, in Minnesota, in the next decade, 300,000 additional people will join the ranks of senior citizens. 300,000 in the next decade. That's 4 times the number of the last 4 decades combined. Whether we want to talk about it or not, our senior population is growing. By 2030, 1 out of 5 Minnesotans will be considered part of the senior population. So it's something that we need to wrap our arms around and need to be willing to have this conversation. In the state of Minnesota, folks look at us as like, this is a great place to live. And if you go by some of the benchmarks, it is. If you look at benchmarks like housing and healthcare and education, then yeah, it is. But I mean, even in the senior population, there was a report that came out from the United Health Foundation that says since 2013, the poverty rate for seniors have actually declined from 8.3 to 7.5. But there's also another side of this story, and it's not a pretty picture, particularly when you look at poverty rate for African American seniors in the state of Minnesota. African Americans are 4 times more likely seniors to live in poverty than the white population. Native Americans and Asian Americans, 2.5 times more likely to live in poverty than the white senior population. Most recently, the Department of Human Services released a report that says since 2009, more and more seniors are accessing tools such as SNAP. We have seen that at the shop that I run. Again, I run a place called Community Actions. You know it because it's next to the Target on University. And so in our shop, we served last year 8,800 seniors who wanted services for energy assistance. That's almost 9,000 seniors a year who are coming to us for energy assistance services. They come to our shop for weatherization for their homes and transition to new employment opportunities. So we understand, I think, the dynamics that's going on in our senior population. One of the most disturbing statistics that's out there is that 60% of seniors pay more than 30% of their income for housing, which makes for them a housing burden. You missed it. Let me do it again. 60% of our seniors pay more than 30% of their income for housing. That is a whole bunch of seniors paying a whole bunch of money for housing. Okay, so I've had 5 minutes. I used up 4.5 minutes. Give me 30 more seconds and I'll be done. As I conclude, my greatest concern is that as the population of seniors grow, more and more seniors will fall beneath the safety net. And there's not going to be the resources there to help. There's a story that I'm reminded of. And the story talks about a group of fishermen who was fishing in the stream. You heard the story. And as they was fishing in the stream, babies was coming down the stream. And they would take the babies out of the stream and take them to get assistance. After a period of time of fishing babies out of the stream, they decided they need to go upstream and figure out who was throwing the babies in the stream. My suggestion and my solution is just that. Is that we cannot keep patchwork our seniors. We need to go upstream and have policies and legislation that protect the elders among us. And for that reason, I am excited that we have a Congresswoman like Medicare. Thank you so much for your time.
Talk about programs that we administer that help older adults in their homes and communities around the state, and just very much appreciate this opportunity that Congresswoman McCollum has made available to all of us to really spend some time and really focus on the core programs that we have in place now, many of which were mentioned already and that are receiving federal funding to provide the supports. And we just really need to maintain those programs, maintain those services, those supports, so that all of us, as we grow older, and maybe just need some help around the house, maybe need some help with our, maybe some personal care needs, some other just daily life activities, maybe help making sure we get the nutrition that we need, that we can meet those needs so that all of us, as we grow older, can age with dignity and independence, and really with the choices that we all want to be able to have as we grow older in our later years. My name is Carrie Benson. I'm with the Minnesota Board on Aging and Department of Human Services, and I'm just going to focus on a few of the programs that I have the distinct pleasure of working on in both those capacities. One thing I do want to highlight, in Ramsey County alone, currently there's about 70,000 people age 65 and older in the county. as Dr. Hightower was mentioning, we've made some progress with the poverty level in the older adult population. However, there's still about 6% of older adults who are living below the poverty level today in Ramsey County. That's about 4,000 individuals. And those are the individuals that we are serving through many of the programs that we benefit from federal funding that provides the support for those programs. Many of these individuals, they rely on the Medicaid program. As the Congresswoman had mentioned earlier, the Medicaid program provides funding for home and community-based services. Those are just those services, as I was mentioning earlier, that provide the daily assistance. You know, maybe it's personal care needs, assistance with bathing, dressing, grooming, being able to get that assistance in your own home if that's what you would choose to do, maybe in an assisted living setting. Medicaid also pays for many of the services, many individuals, the services that they receive in nursing homes as well. So a key federal program that matches state funds that we have in place, thanks to the leadership of the state for many years, to provide this daily assistance that individuals need. For people living in their own homes and receiving assistance through Medicaid programs, they might also get some help with chores, snow shoveling, which I thought we might need help with today, but I guess not. But when it's needed, that's there also to help individuals who might not otherwise have a source for that kind of support, or rides to the doctor. Those simple, really basic, very important activities that we all need to fulfill on a day-to-day basis. These are the same programs that provide this type of key support for people of any age who have disabilities and who need some help meeting those daily living needs, daily life activities. And these are the services that are critical to individuals who have disabilities, but who also want to be a part of the community, as everybody does, who wants to be able to do what they choose to do in their daily life. And so just such critical supports are provided through that Medicaid program. About 28,000 older adults do receive home and community-based services through the Medicaid program today. As Dr. Hightower had just mentioned a few moments ago, with the aging of a population, if the program just stayed as it is today, we would have a very difficult time. We wouldn't be able to serve the same number of people as we're serving today. So we're already looking to the numbers, just the sheer increase in the number of people and the number of people we'd expect to be eligible for that program. We're looking at ways to make changes to the program and how we administer it here in the state, so we can try to maintain as close to the level of service that we have right now in the state for our older population. But if the Medicaid program, and it's called medical assistance here in Minnesota, if that were block granted, and we would assume then the result of that would be cuts to the program, we would have an even tougher time serving anywhere close to the number of people who would be in need of and eligible for the program and the services as it stands today. So we'd have a very significant impact on our older adult population. And likewise, people with disabilities who may be under the age of 65 but are needing some assistance in their daily life as well. The Supplemental and Nutrition Assistance Program is a program administered by the Department of Human Services and was mentioned already a couple times because it is such an important income supplement program funded by the federal government. And we have made great strides, as Dr. Hightower just mentioned, great strides in getting more and more older adults signed up to receive this income supplement so that they have a little bit more income to work with to be sure that they are able to get the healthy food, the well-balanced meals that they want and need each day. So it's another incredibly important piece of the puzzle, so to speak, in terms of those daily supports. About 60% of the older adult population now is signed up for that program, and we hope to be able to maintain that level and keep growing it too. So we're concerned about any changes to the SNAP program that might be under consideration now. Similarly, the Older Americans Act program provides such critical services to older adults. And these are typically services, you might know it best by the Meals on Wheels program, that is the way people tend to refer to the home delivery meals program, that provides meals to people in their homes, delivers on a daily basis, a hot meal, that contact with another individual on that daily basis. We're serving currently about 10,000 older adults with the home delivered meals programs. And many of those individuals are not eligible for the Medicaid program. We're in fact helping to just bring in a couple services that individuals might need to be able to stay in their own home, to stay independent, and just get that help that they need and be able to continue to age well and live well at home. Other services funded through the Older Americans Act that are just as critical are the congregate dining or senior dining programs. So those are the many sites. We have over 500 sites around the state still where older adults gather together on a daily basis for, usually it's a new meal, gather together for that social connection, but that meal as well, that is so critical to helping them meet their nutritional needs. And currently, we're serving about just under 40,000 older adults around the state with that program. This, again, is another federally funded program where we are also bringing in lots and lots of contributions from individuals who are receiving the services, other local donations and matching funds to that. But really, the bulk of it is the federal funding coming in. It's so important to meeting the needs of individuals and really helping people to maintain their independent living, which is what we all want. We serve in total through the Older Americans Act programs about 200,000 older adults in the state of Minnesota. So it's in communities all over the state. We had mentioned the senior linkage line earlier. That's the service where the bulk of the individuals in that 200,000 are served. Just by being able to pick up the phone and call that phone number and find out about services, resources in their communities, be able to figure out how to make sense of Medicare and what are all of the different benefits available to them, and really navigate the mazes of the different programs to which they might want to access. So just some really critical programs that we are so proud to be able to administer on behalf of the older adults that are able to benefit from them, and really are so concerned that we can maintain what we have in this state and really maintain our high ranking as a great state for all of us to age well and live well. Thank you.
Intending to be a poster child for health here this morning. In Minnesota, ice happens, so. Yes, everybody understands. Hot tendons, very bad chairs. Welcome to Hallie Brown Community Center. This is an organization that has been around for 88 years. I want to point to the back. There's a large exhibit there as you exit today. Stop by and view that. It's the history of the African American community in Minnesota, the first families that came here. And it tells you a lot of how the Rondo community came to be and how the people within this community grew and thrived. And here at Hallie, our seniors are our lifeblood. They are the keepers of the flame. They are the elders of the community. They are the ones that we get the stories from. They are the ones that pass down the legacy, the shoulders that I stand on. People like Dorothea Burns, Janabel Taylor, my Uncle Gleason Glover, Roy Wilkins, names that you know you've heard over time, but they are the people who have laid the foundations. And so seniors are a very active part of our community. And it's one of the things that we try to support and honor. And when you look at what is happening on the national stage, we're very thankful to have such a strong advocate, Congresswoman McCollum, who has never turned away from a fight. who has always been there every time we have needed anything and taken and championed our cause at the federal level. And we're very appreciative for the kind of support to have such a strong woman in Washington standing up for all of us. What we provide here is social services, and where it ties into this, it deals much more with the economic aspect and the social aspect. We have two senior groups, the Magnificent Golden Agers and the Retired Men's Club. And so those are people who grew up in the community, not exclusively though. We get people from Woodbury and Burnsville that come in and like to be a part of these groups, but it is a lot of the history when you walk into those rooms and you start talking about what was happening within the community. Those are the ones that we look for our historical memory. And for us, it's something that makes it very necessary to show that we're supporting, to make sure we're fighting for the kinds of supports we can do. And so what we do is we have a food shelf for the clothing closet, and that is our largest program, the basic needs area. Within that, we will go ahead and use tools like Bridge to Benefits to help access what people are eligible for, connect them into resources like MAC and NAPS and SNAP programs, and also to connect them into the healthcare access. It's not something we do here, but we have partners who do that, so it's an easy connection. The problem that we see is how much the need has been increasing and how much the resources are decreasing. To give you just kind of a view, in 2015, we distributed 312,000 pounds of food out of our food shelf. In 2016, we distributed 568,000 pounds. That shows you just how much the need is increasing. And a third of those are seniors. There's seniors from around the community. In June last year, the food shop in Frogtown closed. We saw 34% of those clients come to us. And we use a client choice model that allows people to preserve kind of their dignity. They can shop for what they need. They can pick out things that more fit their dietary needs. But we also have a large section that's open to the community. It's not restricted by geography. And while our client area does 2 zip codes, our community area does 17. And we get people from all around the Twin Cities. And as they come in, we do intake with them, we check in with them and see what are they eligible for, what do they need, what do they have to be connected to, and reach out to our partners. And those phone lines have been ringing off the hook. We've had to add additional staff just to keep up with the increase in need that we see in the community. And so it's one of those areas that is a large focus for us. We're also then been expanding our senior programs from the two groups that we have to add more activities. And so this summer we will be adding additional activities, but it's based upon what we've surveyed our seniors are needing. And top of that list are health-based activities. So it is having clinicians that can come in and at least talk with them about what kind of procedures they can get access to, what kind of things they can do to have better daily lives, getting active, getting fit. All of those are the first things that come up whenever we talk within the rooms about what do you need to have access to. Our community faces a lot of challenges. The need increases, the resources shrink, and the population grows. And as Dr. Hightower mentioned, just in terms of the expansion that we're seeing, we're looking at what can become a crisis. And it's one of those things that everybody needs to pay attention to. We are all getting older. I have come to realize that in many ways, not just precious. But it is one of those things that if we don't maintain the foundations that we have and grow those and expand those, what we're going to end up with is this wide gap. When you look at the donut hole that Congresswoman McCollum was talking about, we saw that increase in our food shelf. People looking for healthy food, nutritional balance, they came to our doors. We had people who had never been here before, who just showed up and said, I need this and I don't know where to go. Can you help us? That's the kind of need that we're seeing, how much it's increasing. It's no longer just referrals. It's no longer just somebody have gotten here through 211. It's people just literally showing up at the door, and they don't know where to go, and they need help. And we have great partner agencies that we work with that do the similar kinds of work, but all of us are seeing that kind of increase. So as we look towards what kind of things can be done, what kind of things can be addressed, I think focusing in on these issues, trying to address them and maintaining what we have and fighting hard for that is going to be the greatest benefit that we have for our community. Thank you.
Without a repeal, it calls into question about the solvency of that program. Dr. Prada, a strong replacement plan. We're also hearing from our younger members about their concerns around pre-existing conditions and that they could lose their insurance. They're concerned that they could be charged more than a younger person with the same plan. Right now, the ACA established a 3-to-1 rating where an older adult, say 64-year-old, can't be charged more than 3 times the premium as a younger adult with the same plan. There's proposals to change that to 5-to-1. Unfortunately, that would increase the cost by $3,000 for an older adult while only saving a younger adult about $700. We're very concerned about the equity of that. Also, Medicaid has been talked about. There's a misconception among a lot of people that Medicare will cover for nursing home care and long-term care. That's not the case. You're all likely aware of that. Medicaid is an important program for people who need help covering that. So we are also very concerned about block grant proposals and per capita caps, as are our members. In terms of Social Security, we're paying close attention to that. AARP does oppose efforts to privatize Social Security. The program keeps nearly 15 million seniors out of poverty. It's a lot of seniors. It provides more than half the household income for nearly half of older Americans. For nearly 1 in 4 seniors, it provides virtually all of their income. And it's not large incomes we're talking about. About half of all seniors are getting by with just an income of a little more than $22,000 a year. Here in Minnesota, Social Security is the only source of income for 3 in 10 Minnesotans age 65 and older. And the average Minnesotan receives about $1,200 a month in Social Security benefits. So again, we're not talking about large incomes here. And there are a lot of people who this is their only source of income. So we're very concerned that cuts to Social Security really could have a detrimental impact on older adults. As it was mentioned, that Social Security can pay out 100% of benefits until 2034. If nothing's done to strengthen that program, some seniors could see an automatic 25% reduction in their Social Security benefits. Imagine losing 25% of your income. Not only has an impact on the lives of people, but it also has an impact on our state's economy. So we're paying really close attention to that, and we'll fight for we'll fight to ensure that that program remains strong and protected for current beneficiaries and current recipients. Just wanted to throw out some of the impact that this could have and what we're hearing from members, and really appreciate the opportunity to talk to you today.
Right around here in Ramsey, and I represent part of Washington County, the same thing I'm sure is true there. And as Gary pointed out, the federal budget and the state budget are intertwined, but they're intertwined with another budget that sometimes doesn't get talked about, and that's the seniors' personal budget. What happens with that? Thank you for kind of tying that together about Social Security. During the Great Recession, the one thing I heard over and over and over again as people who had 401ks watched the dollars go down that they were monthly going to receive, so with that, so we're going to open this up to some questions, and Jamal, how are we working this?
So, you have the first question about the life incentive.
Okay, do you have a first question? If you just your first name. Hi, good morning, I'm so glad you came.
My concern is around the Medicaid cuts being proposed. Let me tell you a bit about myself. I'm in graduate school at the University of Minnesota and should have my PhD in about 2 years in the history of science and technology. I have written 2 book reviews on academic books in my field. I have co-authored a chapter in a book on universal design in college education, and I am the sole author of a chapter in a book on gender and work. I have presented my research at both regional and national conferences. I have consulted with professors from MIT, NYU, and Kansai University in Japan, providing suggestions on resources regarding disabilities. In fact, my co-authored chapter was an assigned reading for a class at NYU. I'm godmother to my best friend and classmate's little boy. I have friends and colleagues. This is what Medicaid pays for. It pays for the ability for me to live my life. It pays for my wheelchair, my medications, my therapies, and my physicians. It pays for my aide who helps me do all the things I just mentioned. There is no way states can financially cover the proposed cuts, which means there will have to be cuts in services. Those cuts mean I lose vital parts of my life. I live at home with my mom and without an aide. She has to provide 24-hour care, which is exhausting and impacts her health. Those cuts mean I lose at least some of my ability to impact the world for the better. I wanted to testify today because I wanted to put a face on this issue. When the House debates these cuts, I want you to be able to say, wait a minute, this is how this affects one of my constituents, one who has voted in every election since she turned 18. I have overcome a lot of barriers in my life. Please don't let Congress erect another one. Thank you.
Fathers and people on disability come into my office when I served on Health and Human Services and really learned about the vibrancy in the community, whether it's hearing impaired, speech impaired, mobility impaired. You know, these are people who are in our community who are adding to it every single day, and they do it in a very quiet and, I have to say, most invisible way. So I'm so proud, really, people from the disability community are coming to my town hall meetings because it is a lot of extra work for them. Thank you very, very much. We have a microphone up that we have put in the center of the room, and you had your hand up. I'm going to try to go back as far as I can, so this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to describe people by what they're wearing, and then we'll see how we get. So, the woman in the beautiful floral, you come up. The woman in the cozy green scarf. Then we have the gentleman in the blue shirt. If you kind of get up behind, because then we'll just kind of keep things going. You are really reaching up there, the woman in the black tee. And then we have a gentleman who's shaded in the dark, way in the back, directly in front of me. Yes, you, sir. Yes, with the two of you coming forward. And why don't you go get in the line, and then we'll see how we're doing. I'm going to pull this back a little bit so we can see the panel. Please, just your first name and just your remarks.
Okay. My name is Connie, and we had a chance to meet actually at the Wilder Center about a year ago where I spoke with colorectal cancer. And I am a two-time cancer survivor. I went in at 50 years old and got my baseline colonoscopy and was diagnosed with stage 3 colon cancer, a ball-sized tumor, and then it metastasized into my liver, so I am a cancer survivor. And got in for that colonoscopy.
Yeah,
so you gotta go. One of the things that just terrorizes me, I literally wake up in the middle of the night, is continuation of care, you know, pre-existing conditions. I literally find myself just like you fall out of an airplane, boom, in your bed, terrified, because I just don't know what my future holds. And so the question today is, cancer patients and survivors need coverage that is available to people with pre-existing conditions that is affordable and adequate to cover treatment for and follow-up care. Will you oppose any bill that does not keep the patient protections in place and ensure that coverage is affordable and adequate.
Yes, it will, and that's why we need to see what the replacement looks like. And so there's two things that she touched on in her comment. One was pre-existing conditions. You know, all of us know people who were shut out or couldn't afford policies in the past and now have access to policies now. And the second is, with some of the discussions going back with the high cost of the, you know, you're going to buy the low cost insurance, but then you're going to have a high deductible and you're going to have this and your head's spinning around because now no one's speaking plain English about what your insurance policy covers anymore. But I don't want to go back to the days where we get phone calls in our office where people paid into insurance for years and then had a major medical episode and now are looking at having to file bankruptcy because their insurance reached their cap. And they're still, sometimes it's with the child in their household. So you have my commitment to make sure that we do the right thing.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing your story.
Hi, I'm Abby.
Abby, if you'd move closer to the mic, because your friends and neighbors in the back want to hear you.
First of all, I'd like to thank Congresswoman McCollum for being part of the Parkinson's Caucus. And I'm one of the babies that is floating down the river right on the edge that Dr. Hightower mentioned, because I am 58. My husband was forced to retire early because of Parkinson's. And I'm also part of the demographic who, in 2003, women over 55 were 25% of the unemployed. We are now, since 2012, 50%. That's the largest group, and long-term unemployed. I also have a pre-existing condition, most people my age do. We do get by on my husband's Social Security, and he's covered by Medicare. I'm also one of the poster people that the insurance companies made at that small 2.5%. Because we make enough that I'm on private insurance, but boy, we were the poster child to scare everybody else. And I can't afford health insurance if it goes up to 5-1. Right now I'm on a policy that's $714 a month. And I get to pay the first $6,590 in expenses. So I'm not going to the doctor. I can't afford it. So is there a way to increase? As you can tell, I'm also in the position of a caretaker for my husband.
Yes.
So I can't get a job, even if it's available. And I'm really stuck. What happens? Social Security isn't going to be there for me until I'm 67. So I have no health insurance possibilities other than the Affordable Care Act. And it's going to be incredibly expensive. I can't go to the doctor from now until then. Or, God forbid, what happens if I die and my husband has nobody to take care of me?
Thank you for sharing your story. You've got a lot of things in there, and I'll just touch on a few of them. And if there's any way you think our congressional office, and I pull this out because we work with the Senior Linkage Line and AARP, so here's a resource at Clarence and with the Community Action, there might be some resources that we can, you know, find that might be available to ease some of your burden. But one of the things that, when I mentioned the Affordable Care Act isn't perfect, the Affordable Care Act didn't have one component in it that I fought very hard in the House to have in, was a public option. Because a public option was really important. Yeah. Minnesota wouldn't have seen what had happened with this insurance. You know, the one thing that we, there were many people, and there's people in this room that support single payer. But one of the things we knew we weren't going to be able to move forward with single payer, we had to do something. And so the fact that the public option is missing out of the Affordable Care Act is a huge hole in my heart and would provide so many more opportunities. So there's many of us saying, we know what we can do to fix this for so many folks. We hear from you, the state of Minnesota has been supportive of that, our governor has been supportive of that. So there's room to make improvements. But thank you for sharing your story. And I want to put a plug in for women. There's really great guys here in the audience. I know that, part of my panel. But women get in a squeeze play with Social Security very, very different than most of our brothers and our fathers and our uncles do. And that is because the hours worked. I know of people who, you know, stayed home with their kids, you know, full-time maybe for 5 or 7 years, then worked part-time while they were still kind of in grade school, started working full-time, and all of a sudden you had, in your case it was a spouse, but had a parent or somebody, all of a sudden it was like, you know, somebody needs to take the doctor's appointment, somebody needs to do this, somebody needs to do that. Quite often it falls on the woman. And that's why when you look at poverty statistics for women in this country, it is because that they have been the caretakers for the beginning of the life for their children and the end of their life for their parents. And so that's why when I see women in poverty, it really, really makes me motivated to do something about the way we count Social Security credits and the way that we also reward people who are.
The Affordable Care Act repeal also affects prevention, which, as you know, it's a reduction in public health expenditures. Public health money that comes to the Minnesota benefits spent on screening, cancer screening, and immunization, and disease surveillance. So as we think about those kind of investments, I'd love to see some of you attention paid to prevention efforts too. The other thing is, I was just reading Politico on Twitter, they just think the plan is as bad as you fear. It's Medicaid per capita block grants, it's a 5-to-1 H ban, it's punting the essential health benefit for the states, it's a reduction in cost sharing. I mean, it's what they wanted to do and what they said they will do, but now they're going to have to hear from people about what to do. So do the best you can to resist.
Help me fight for that right, and we got that. And then we also had other services like Goodwill Easter Seals help me get a job. And so I have a lot better life here in Minnesota than I had in Wisconsin. And I also live on my own now, too, as of 2012. So I'm very happy for the public housing service. And one thing I'm really grateful for was, even though they told me it was going to be a long wait, they were able to get me in a year. And so that was awesome. I live right now next to you. And that's another concern, too, for another topic. I'm concerned I don't want that service cut or anything done to that. I don't want the waiting list to grow. Because, you know, I try to encourage my friends at work, you know, some of the people that are immigrants, some that, you know, are just, you know, just trying to get out and live on their own and may not have the income, you know, sign up for public housing. That's a great way. I mean, I like that. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for sharing. Hiring freeze. So when you do across the board cuts, you're cutting housing, you're cutting a lot of the other supportive services, transportation. Across the board cuts don't solve anything. The other thing that they're cutting is medical research and some of the diseases and some of the improvements we can make in people's lives and save money as well as save lives. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having us today. My name is Starla Krause, and I just want to say I've lived through my parents having pretty good lives on Medicare, and they had many, many medical problems, and it was always covered. And so why I'm here today is I just want to know what we do to tell Washington that the issue is so simple, single payer. They are giving tax breaks to the wealthiest people, the corporations pay no taxes, and why do they want to see us all poor on the streets? And I just want you to know what, I call my congressman all the time. I haven't called Mr. Trump's office yet, but, and there was 100,000 people in St. Paul on January 22nd. Why aren't they listening to us?
First of all, thank you for doing this today. My name is Bill. I'm here with my wife, Shannon. I just want to say for the record that I was not paid by the Republican Party to be here. I'm a Republican. I've never voted for you. My wife and I purchase insurance on the individual market. I make too much money, so we're not eligible for subsidies. Last year, today, my wife was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. She's here today. I have a chance to earn my vote. We know what's working. You have a chance to earn my vote because my party has abandoned me. So we know it's working with the Affordable Care Act. We also know it's not working with the Affordable Care Act. And one thing that my party keeps talking about is HSAs, health savings accounts. Health savings accounts are not health insurance. And every chance that you have to let your counterparts, my party in Congress, know that health savings accounts are not health insurance. We would have spent, our health savings account is fully funded, we would have spent it 76 times last year. So my question to you, Congresswoman, is, I'm also deathly afraid of high risk pools. So what are you planning to do to help fix the Affordable Care Act? And what can I do to help you keep the ACA being repealed?
Yes.
We have to, first and foremost, I think, as I mentioned earlier, get a public option, and that's more affordable for more Americans. Secondly, we have to work on drug costs, because a lot of the costs that your family is going to be experiencing or is experienced right now are going to be pharmaceutical related. And
100,000 last year.
And so just doing
that was all covered by health insurance because of the Affordable Care Act.
The health savings accounts and that was supposed to be kind of supplement some of the necessity necessities that you might need. It was like for hearing aids and glasses and things that I actually think should be covered better by insurance. And so the way it's being bandied around now, that becomes your health.
They talk about it like it's health insurance.
Right. One of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle was talking about, oh, no problem, we'll just go back to the high-risk pools, we'll just go back to MSHA. Well, folks, I served in Health and Human Services in the state of Minnesota, and MSHA did not help families in this state from going bankrupt.
That's right. No.
And so that's not the solution either. So
So what can we do to help you?
Yes.
Yeah. So the senators are going to do everything that they can. We need, how many of you know someone who lives in another congressional district? We need to start telling those people to pick up the phone and call. This is not a Minnesota value. And I know that for a fact because of the work that Minnesota did in MinCare, the way that we led the fight for something as simple as diabetics, needles being covered by insurance policies. There was a time when it wasn't. This is not a Minnesota value to walk out on fellow Minnesotans. It's not an American value either. But in Minnesota, we have a long history of working to improve health care for everyone and leaving no one behind. So, I talk to my colleagues on a regular basis. I'm going to ask them how their town halls went.
Last Jeff has said, what can we do? You send letters, you send postcards, you call. My wife and I send a minimum of 4 postcards, letters, or emails every single day. If everybody did it in 1 month, we'd still want to do this, okay? Here's my concern. My concern is that Mitchell and Ryan will use a divide and conquer approach to Social Security and Medicare. Let me give you an example of that. All of you who are above 55 years old, don't worry, you'll have your Medicare and Social Security, okay? They cut us off of the conversation, and most seniors say, well, I'm gonna get whatever, you know, should I deserve, and then we shut up.
No, we don't.
And then what happens is, some years later, well, it's working so well for the young people, of course they haven't received anything yet, then they hit us with the same thing. That's what I'm worried about, is that they silence the people that really could speak out more than anybody else, because we have more time. So, anyhow, that's my big concern.
I have someone who's gonna speak to that. Someone who's leading the charge on that with the age group that you're talking
about. By the way, I am a member of AARP.
I like to hear that. One of the things that I will say is that what we've been telling a lot of our younger members, because we have gotten the question, well, you know, people will be grandfathered in and it will be different for us coming in. For those who are currently on Medicare, even if they are grandfathered in and out, I think we need a different term for that, but grandparents, yes. But one of the things I will say is under a voucher proposal and under that system, you all of a sudden have people leaving traditional Medicare to go into the private market to purchase insurance with their voucher. What that does is drives up the cost for people currently on Medicare. So even if those individuals are going to be grandparented into the program, their costs will go up and there's still a voucher. So that's all out of pocket. So regardless of kind of, you know, looking forward and saying, oh, it's working for the younger people, this will work. All it does is drive up those costs for everyone regardless of age.
Well, I get to be the most, as my grandmother would say, the stump of the picnic, the most unpopular person in the room. The reason why I called on the numbers, I kind of knew how many I could get through before the end of our time. So to all the questioners up here, here's what, we have forums. My staff will be here for a while. If there's something specific we can get back, a comment you want to share, because I want to be respectful of everyone's time here, including some of the folks who are here probably have other appointments and that, as well as I have something that I have to get to in a little bit here. But I want to thank Aaron and Carrie and Clarence and Jonathan. for being here. And the reason why it's important to have a panel, even though you didn't get as many questions, is we're all in this together. This just isn't Congress, it's state, it's local, it's community, it's our faith community, it is us as individuals, and it's us holding our government accountable to make sure that we don't leave anybody behind. So thank you all so very, very much.
Yeah. No. 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 No